This morning's message is entitled, The Two Most Important Words in Christianity. So, for a couple minutes, I want you to think of, in your mind and in your heart, the two most important words in Christianity. Okay? Got them? Don't overanalyze it, just, you got them. Okay? Ready? On the count of three, I'm going to have you go ahead and say those two words. Ready? One, two, three. Two of the most important words. Now, I did not hear my two words. My two words are this. The two most important words in Christianity are come and go. Come and go. And in the outline that you have, you will see a variety of marks there. Lines, and all of those represent something. I'm going to take you on an excursion, I trust, and it's my prayer and my sense in God's leading what I want to share with you today, the burden on my heart. You don't have to look these passages up. I'm going to give them to you. Look them up later. If you want to go ahead and you know, do Bible quiz drills and try to get to the passage before I do, I cheated. Mine are all marked. Well, I didn't cheat. They're marked because I want you to hear, and I want you to experience, and I want you to feel why these two words, come and go, are the two most important words in Christianity. Now, none of your words were wrong. They're different from mine, but they weren't wrong. Listen to these things. They're the heart of why I chose those two. In everything we are, we are to come to Jesus. We're to come to Jesus. If there is a more simple explanation of what Christianity is about, it's the fact that you and I come to Jesus. And we come to Jesus in the entirety of our lives. The entirety of our lives. You will never know what God has in store for you. You will never experience all that God has laid aside in His crucifixion and death on the cross and His resurrection from the dead, His filling of our lives with the Holy Spirit, unless we will come to Jesus. We miss everything else. Now, that doesn't say that people can't, in essence, be happy and have a fulfilled life. They can. But eternal life, the life that we have because we have a relationship with God, all comes about because we have come to Jesus. In Romans chapter 10, beginning with verse 9, it says this. It tells us in Scripture that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the Scripture says, whoever believes on Him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Gentile, for the same Lord over all is rich to all who call upon Him. For whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. But you got to come to Jesus. Salvation is coming to Jesus. You cannot save yourself. You cannot be good enough to please God. If you stood toe to toe, eyeball to eyeball with God, and He says, why should I let you in heaven? What would your answer be? One of the qualifying questions of evangelism explosion. Why should God let you into heaven? I know the answer. I've come to Jesus. Through salvation, through making a conscious decision, through Him ministering to me, that new life, that becoming a creation, a new creation, a new life, born again, becoming a believer, a Christian, whatever it is, you got to come to Jesus for salvation. You won't find it any other place. Second thing I want you to realize is the fact that you and I are not saved by our performance. There's nothing that aggravates me more than people trying to prove to me how spiritual they are. You're not here to please Jesus on the basis of performance. And you will say to me, well, you've been here since November, and most of the sermons you preach are about how I need to change my life. Okay, but you're not saved on the basis of performance. I'm not asking you to be so good that God has to let you into heaven without anything else. I want to remind you what happens when we take on His righteousness, when we live out His righteousness. Because in that moment in which you were born again, your guilt, your sin was all taken away. It was forgiven. And what God did instead was place in you the righteousness of Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21 says this. It says, "For He made Him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in ourselves." That's not what it says. In Him. You see, you can't have the righteousness of God unless you come to Jesus for it. And He will provide that for you through His shed blood, through His broken body, through His resurrection from the dead, from His death on the cross. Your righteousness is not yours. Yours is as filthy rags. But the righteousness that is ours in salvation is because we have come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. In Exodus chapter 15, it tells us this in verse 26. "I am the Lord who heals you. I am the Lord who heals you." In the Christian Missionary Alliance, we believe in a statement of faith. And one of the parts of that statement of faith has to do with four distinctives that we teach and preach. Jesus Christ, our Savior, our Sanctifier, our Healer, and our coming King. A lot of times when we pray for physical needs. A lot of the praying that takes place in many churches is the praying for physical needs. We face physical needs. But the Bible tells me the healing and the healer is Jesus. In James chapter 5, verses 14 and on, it says this, "If any are sick among you, let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Confess your trespasses one to another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much." God says, look, I have healing for you. Now, this is not a message on healing. I just want you to remember that if you want to be healed, who do you come to? You come to Jesus. Why? He's the healer. Now, I know that there'll be plenty of you who will say, well, I've done that, or my mother did that, or my father did that, somebody did that, and they died. The worst thing to happen to a Christian believer is not death. Because I want to tell you something, cancer, resurrection takes care of that. Difficulties breathing, diabetes, resurrection takes care of that. And though we can come to God for strength in our lives right here, right now, that we can come for healing right here and right now, that we can face all the terrible and horrible things that would take us out of this world, Jesus still claims to be the healer. And if you want to know the healer, you need to come to Jesus. And He's the healer not only of our bodies. He's the healer of our emotions. He's not only the healer of our emotions, He's the healer of our spirit. He is our healer, body, soul, and spirit. He is our healer, and we can come to Him. That's why come is one of the two most important words in Christianity. Let me take you back for a minute into the Gospel of John. And in John chapter 17, I want you to look at this with me. This is Jesus' prayer for his people. And in John chapter 17, it says this in verse 20. I do not pray for these alone, but also for those who will believe in me through their word. So Jesus is praying for the 11 disciples. And he is praying for his extended believers in that day. And he is praying for you in this day. When you sit in this church right now, I do not pray for these alone, those there right then in that present moment, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that's you and me, that they all may be one as you, Father, are in me and I in you. And that they may also be one with us, that the world may believe that you have sent me. And the glory which you gave me, I have given them, that they may be one just as we are one. In them, I in them, and you in me, that they may be made perfect in one, that the world may know that you have sent me and have loved them as you have loved me. There's a great book by Professor Siemens that said, The Search for Significance. All of us have situations that deal with our own personal view of ourselves, our self-worth. I want you to know something. For a Christian believer, your self-significance is in Jesus Christ. The fullness of who you are, the fullness of all God wants you to be, is in Him and in Him alone. This passage says, I want them to be in me, and I want to be in them, and I want you to be in them, and me to be in them, and them to be in me, and them to be in you. God wants us to take our significance, not from our culture, not from our peers, but from who? From Him. You've got to come to Jesus. Come to Jesus and find significance. In Romans chapter 8 and in verse 22, there's this great passage of Scripture. Of course, all of Romans chapter 8, as we found out in Sunday school, is great. But in Romans chapter 8, verse 22, it says this, For we know that the whole creation groans and labors with birth pangs together until now. Not only that, but we also who have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves grown within ourselves, eagerly waiting for the adoption, the redemption of our body, for we were saved in this hope. You got to come to Jesus for hope. Don't wait for the next election. Don't wait for the next best thing that comes out of Hollywood. Don't wait for the next best toy to come on the market. Either a small Ferrari or a really large Ferrari. Your hope is in none of those things. Your hope, my hope, is in who? One more time. That hope here in Romans chapter 8 says, that hope is in Jesus. And you find that hope and know that hope, not by what you see on the next Oprah show or Dr. Phil show or The View or whatever else it is that claims to give hope to our society. Our hope is in Jesus Christ. The last thing I want you to remember with me is the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. You got to come to Jesus for your daily bread. Daily bread physically, daily bread emotionally, daily bread spiritually. That is yours by coming to Jesus. That is yours. Because in coming to Jesus, we can experience salvation and righteousness and healing and significance and hope and our daily bread. in that prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray, he says, our daily bread, what we need every day, what we need every day is supplied in the person of Jesus Christ. That's the first word. Come. Come. Be saved. Live righteously. Come and lay your burdens before him. Find in him your significance. Come and find true, everlasting hope. Come and know your daily bread met. There's also a second word. And that second word for me is go, is to go for Jesus. You know, and can quote with me, I'm sure with no problem, the Great Commission from Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 through 20. To go to the nations, to take the nations the gospel, the good news, to teach them. That passage of Scripture resounds with the Christian and Missionary Alliance. We saw a little bit about what we do. We live in a day and age. You and I live in the day of the Christian and Missionary Alliance, where a lot of our missionary children in those nations have grown up, and they are now sending missionaries all over the world. Jesus said, all authority is given unto me, so you go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I'm with you always. He is commissioning those who have come to him to go with him, to go for him. In Ephesians chapter 2, and in verse 3, I want you to hear what he says. In Ephesians chapter 3, listen to these words. And have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather expose them. For it is shameful even to speak of those things which are done by them in secret. But all things are exposed, all things are made manifest by the light. For whatever makes manifest is light. Therefore, he says, awake you who sleep, arise from the dead, and Christ will give you light. You and I come because of the person and work of Jesus Christ, who has dispelled all the darkness and has taken the opportunity instead to give us light. And he has told us and taught us to do that through this thing called boldness. It tells me, according to the eternal purpose which he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence through faith in him. Therefore, I ask that you do not lose heart at my tribulations for you, which is your glory. You and I, we go for Jesus with a boldness because light always supersedes darkness, a boldness because it is you in him that lives out this life. In 1 John chapter 3, it tells us that we are his children. Listen to these words from this passage of Scripture. In 1 John, it tells us this. Chapter 3, verse 1. Behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed on us, that we should be called the children of God. Therefore, the world does not know us because it does not know him. Beloved, now we are the children of God. You walk into life not as some defeated, not as some dejected, demoralized, discouraged individual. You go as a child of God. Well, wait a minute. You go as a child of God. Yeah, you're going to face difficulties. You're going to face troubles. You will face those things. It's part of the world. But you're his child. I will never forget at Mahaffey Camp. And we were doing something. I forget exactly the exact context, but I was on security a good many years ago. And some kid was kind of lost. And he got found. And his dad came. And as soon as that kid saw his dad coming down that hill, He looked at us on the security force kind of timidly at first, but then he looked at me and he says, "That's my dad." Have you forgotten who your dad is? You are children, and if you're children, then you are joint heirs with Christ. Again, I turn back to the book of Ephesians. And in that book of Ephesians, I want you to consider with me these words from Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 7. That in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. You and I are exhibits of grace. Wait a minute, I don't know that I want to be an exhibit of grace. I don't know if I want to be an exhibit of forgiveness. I don't know if I want to be an exhibit of trusting Jesus in every situation. I don't know if I want to be an exhibit of love. I don't know if I want to be an exhibit of an open arm to people. But that's exactly what we're called to do, because we're to go for Jesus. We're to go into the nations, into all the world. We're to go in his boldness, and we're to go because we're his kids. And what are we to do? Exhibit his grace. Live out his grace. In 2 Corinthians, in chapter 5, it tells me this. In verse 18, "Now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ, and has given us the ministry of reconciliation." When you go into your schools, when you go into your workplaces, when you go into your families, you are taking the opportunity to go with a purpose, and that purpose is the message of reconciliation. Here's the message that the Punxsutawney Alliance Church has for the Punxsutawney community. Jesus. Get that? Period. It's not about our church programs, though I trust that we will develop and have and pray church programs that will meet the needs of people around us, that will show them Jesus. But the only thing we have to offer this community is not even us, it's him. And it is the message of his reconciliation. I want you to invite people to church. I want you to come with them. I want you to invite them to special events that we have. I want you to take the opportunity to find ways in which we can get your friends into the presence of Jesus. But when it comes right down to it, when it comes right down to it, it's not what we sing. It's not what we preach. It's not what we pray. It's a person. And who's the person? Who's the person? Who's the person? That's the only thing we have to offer. Only thing we have to offer. We are to go into all the world. We are to go with boldness. We are to go as his children, knowing the delights and the joys of walking with him. We are to go as exhibition of grace and love and mercy. And we are to go with a person who says, "Oh, be reconciled to God." The only way that that will ever happen, the only way we will ever experience that, is through a person and through his work, Jesus Christ. And then finally, I want you to understand something. The New Testament is replete by telling us that we are his body. This is one body of believers of a whole lot of body of believers. And listen. We're his arms, we're his feet, we're his voice, we're his life, and we're his love, because we are his body. Because we are his body, you and I are to go for Jesus. Come to Jesus and go for Jesus. To go for Jesus, because if that person needs a hug, who will he have hug him? No, who? If he needs somebody to walk a mile or go an extra mile with him, who is that? And if he calls somebody to love them, who is that? Okay, you're kind of wearing down on me. They're all the same answers, by the way. When we need to show a community something that will transform them, it is the life that is in the person of Jesus Christ. And where are they going to look for that life? If they're looking for love, the love of God that is being exhibited in a group of people, who do you think that's pointed to? The words that you shared at the very beginning of this sermon, I appreciate. But I want you to consider my two for these moments as I close this message. I want you to consider that the two most important words in Christianity are come to Jesus and go for Jesus. And I want you to be a person who will say, you know what? I had two really good words. Pastors aren't bad. And I'm going to commit myself. I'm going to commit myself to come to Jesus. To come to Jesus for my salvation, to come to Jesus for my righteousness, to come to Jesus for my healing, to come to Jesus for my significance, to come to Jesus for my hope, and to come to Jesus for my daily bread. That's why it's so important to come. And then I'm going to ask you to be people committed to go. To go for Jesus to all nations, to go with a boldness, to come with the identity of His children, to come as an exhibit of His grace, and to come with a name, and to come with a message, and to come with reconciliation, and to proclaim the only thing we have to offer is Jesus. And to realize that we are to go and be His arms, go and be His feet, go and be His voice, go and be His life, go and be His love. And I want you to look at me as we close this service. There is not one of you who cannot do this. In your way, empowered by His Spirit. Not my way, not somebody else, your way. Two most important words in Christianity, come and go. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads and close your eyes. I want you in this moment, in your heart and your spirit, to answer these questions. The first question, have you come to Jesus? Have you experienced Him as your Lord and Savior? Have you taken that step to believe, to confess, and to be changed? To know that you're forgiven, and to know that there's a life in you to be lived. Have you done that? If you haven't, one of our elders, one of our deaconesses, Pat and I, we would love to share with you. Maybe the person you came with today, maybe the person you're sitting next to. But come to Jesus. If you know Him, we don't just come to Him once. We keep coming to Jesus for all those things we need, our significance, our hope. So if you come to Jesus, second question, are you willing to go? I'm not asking you to go to Africa right now. I'm not asking you to go to Niger, 110 degrees sometimes. I'm not asking you to do anything but to say to God, I am willing to go because of how important this word is. In our understanding of our belief. This morning, have you come to Jesus? And are you willing to go? Lord, I pray for your people right now. I pray for people who may not know you as Lord and Savior, that they will come to you. I pray for us as believers who will continue to come to you for what we need in our lives. And I pray, Lord, that there are people here who will draw the line in the proverbial sand and say, I'm willing to go. I'm willing to go to the nations if you want me. I'm willing to go across the street if you want me. I'm willing to do what you want me to do. And Lord, in your own sweet voice and own sweet way, will you tell them you want them to do just that? And I'll thank you, Jesus, as I pray and ask these things in your blessed and mighty name. Amen.